Artists come and go. Some get big, some never find success. It's the well-known nature of the beast. But it's not every day we see a band come around that had the potential to be huge, but simply missed the boat. It's also not that often that a band has such a striking and important message. Inner Party System was a band from the late 2000s who were given the short end of every stick that they pulled. A band whose sound was both too late and too early, and a band who wrote one of the greatest electronic rock albums ever made. An album with a warning, one that we failed to hear, and one that has only become more relevant as it's aged. While the group had disbanded and gone their separate ways over 10 years ago at this point, I still find myself going back to them and sitting in awe on just how spot on they were in their criticism of both culture and society. So let's talk about the warning we ignored. Let's talk about Inner Party System. I've got this planet in my hands. You know I'll waste it if I can. Come on, let's give it a twist. And if it all turns to shit, oh wait, let's try that again.
If I get old, I've got nothing. Some people in this town go through their whole lives without ever feeling alive. Some just never get out.
We're just boring, really.
Forming from the ashes of band members Jared Picone and Patrick Neasley's previous project, The Takeover, the name Inner Party Systems was chosen as it's a reference to George Orwell's most well-known work and a warning of his own, 1984. The name is a direct reference to the inner party referenced in the book, the inner party being the upper class consisting of 2-3% of the population, essentially the counterpart of the real world's 1%. They're the ones who live in indulgence and luxury while pushing and enforcing the law and will of Big Brother onto the rest of the populace. When asked about it, Jared Picone stated,
"Social classes were defined as the inner party, outer party, and the working class. It sounds real holier than thou when you say it. We're not really full of ourselves, but we like the idea of creating this full, multimedia, overstimulating, elitist environment that we're trying to invite everyone into. It's the ironic elitist class."
While the name Inner Party System might sound silly to most, especially in the context of late 2000s culture and how that name might just sound like a silly MySpace artist making ear-grating indie pop,
past 3 years I swear I've been a better man.
It's actually extremely fitting with the ironic nature of its origin. Inner Party System might have some danceable beats and bass lines to their music, but the lyrics, atmosphere, and overall tone, even from day one, was anything but a party. The music was drenched in socio-political satire, discontent with where the world was heading, and a clear disgust with modern culture. In the short year after its formation, Inner Party System finally came to be in 2007, quickly releasing its first offering, the Download EP, a 6-song release composed of 5 songs and 1 remix. And while it sounds more like a demo than a full-fledged debut EP, it makes up for its rough production quality with a lot of character and promise. Download is 24 minutes of groundwork being laid, with each song giving a small taste of what's to come. 2 of the songs off the EP would later appear in the band's debut full-length, starting off with the heavily political Don't Stop, and finishing off with the desperate and mournful Lovers Dancing. And while I could dig into a lot regarding the contents of this EP like I normally would, 2 of the songs we'll cover later, so I want to focus on just a single track here, and that song is The Lovers Dancing, the EP's closing track. The Lovers Dancing is easily tied with Don't Stop as the EP's strongest and most fleshed out track. It's an upbeat song that carries itself with an overbearingly remorseful atmosphere. The song has a driving drum beat and bass line that slightly descend at the end of every measure, complemented by soaring melancholic vocals that guide instruments as they play.
Moving through my hands. I'm building and making a beautiful thing that will never be made.
lyrics are the main standout of the track, however, keeping us grounded in the world that the EP presents to us.
Now they can tell our hearts are heavy. You can tell it in our voice. This will give them all the reason now, and we won't have a choice. As hopeless as it may have been, the love is still moving through my hands. I'm building and making a beautiful thing that will never be made again.
This is the second verse of the song, giving us a look at how our protagonist sees his crumbling world. Feeling the heaviness and uncertainty of the way the world around him is developing and the frivolous and quickly crumbling nature of human relationships. And while he even senses the very same realization in his lover, it's clear that it's too late. The hopelessness of the situation sets in, and as the song fades out, we hear the final few words of the track.
They are the lovers dancing, so motionless, alone. They are the lovers dancing, so hopeless and alone.
Has the economy got you down?
Are you fat,
ugly,
impotent,
depressed?
Well then you need a new
car. Come down and see me.
Crazy Pat.
That inner party system of Moe.
Price is so low, you'll think we're...
In fact, we're gonna trade you a brand new car for...
Your soul. That's right, we're giving away cars for souls. You weren't choosing yours anyway.
We'll throw in a free CD.
It's the music of the devil.
But I love it.
The inner party system.
We've lost it.
In 2008, the magnum opus of the band would come in the form of their debut and only full-length, the eponymous self-titled album. A record just under an hour that takes everything promised from the Download EP and transforms it into a large, uncompromising, and hauntingly beautiful experience. To say that Inner Party System is a once-in-a-lifetime album is an understatement. It's a record that is close to 15 years old and still sounds like it could have been released yesterday. The album is a massive step up in both production quality and songwriting. Also, it's fitting in its name, as the record really captures everything the band represented and goes above and beyond what anyone could have expected from a debut. When I say that the band tried to give us a warning, I mean it. The world, situations, and overall feel this album presents to us are those of a decaying, corrupt society that not only reflects the one of the book the band's name originates from, but one that is more realistic and believable to our own world, and one that we seem to be progressing further and further towards as this record ages. The album starts off with Die Tonight, Live Forever, a nasty club track drenched in distorted synths and pounding percussion, only to lead to a reprieve of ambiance and Patrick's soft vocals in the pre-chorus before we are once again thrown into the darkness. This night should take my Some of the most telling lyrics of the song are,
"You can see the plastic dripping off her face. We may not all be pretty, but we feel pretty fake."
A line describing the fading beauty of our fake and self-obsessed culture, only to be followed by the chorus,
"If this night should take my life, we've got nothing left. If we all should die tonight, we've got nothing left."
A depressing admission of the emptiness that we have embraced as our society has decayed into a nihilistic hellscape. The song is followed up by an instant change of pace with the track Last Night in Brooklyn, a slower tempo song about a drug-riddled one-night stand, where Patrick sings about being intoxicated at a party and sleeping with a foreign model, only to find himself alone and unfulfilled the next morning.
She blends it in.
The song really delves into that loathsome feeling most of us know all too well from chasing such hollow pleasure like one-night stands and intoxication, only for us to realize we gave up the things that truly made us happy in our frivolous pursuit. Don't Stop was the band's most popular song and the closest they ever got to a hit, a brilliantly produced industrial rock song that cuts deep with its lyrics. The song details sacrificing your life for fame in the entertainment industry. Patrick embraces narcissism to cover up his shame for his evil deeds.
I am
I said, it really embraces that narcissism, but also it describes the fact that entertainment has become nothing more than propaganda, with the masses still embracing and outright worshipping celebrities who only see them as little more than pathetic insects to step on.
This is entertainment. Lies are entertainment. You were down on your knees begging me for more.
It's almost comical how popular this song got, considering it was released during the height of reality TV. It really goes to show just how little some people pay attention to the lyrics, given that it outright mocks the same people who would have been dancing to it during its time playing on Fuse or MTV or something. This track is followed up by Structure, a song delving into the idea of changing, possibly finding God and being born again if the "when the water turns to wine" line is to be taken as such. The lyrics on this track are beautiful yet haunting. Patrick sings of a person who once lived a decadent lifestyle of drinking and lust, a lifestyle that leads him to feel empty and void.
You suck the bottle dry.
In the chorus, Patrick begs to know why they've changed. It's an incredibly relatable form of grief when someone outgrows us in their lifestyle and journey on this planet. The most telling passage of the song is in its second verse.
The nights are getting cold, those faces growing old, and there's nothing you can do. So sing your sad excuses, you've got the scars to prove it, and I'm sure they'll all sing along.
Everyone Is the Same follows next, and feels like a part two of Structure. The track has a much more poppy and light sound to it, and details Patrick fighting with himself over the life that he lived, talking about wanting to see the higher end of life but not relating to it, and even if he did, not being able to afford it. A realization that he really isn't one of the inner party that the album and band's name refers to, all ending with Patrick asking what the listener would do if they were somebody else. Obsession is the next song on the album and follows a much more simple and stripped down club track formula.
What keeps the pressure building? What takes your breath away? What do I have to do to make you want to fall in love with?
The lyrics detail an obsessive and superficial desire to be loved by someone, though the lyrics remain a bit ambiguous on whether this is Patrick's desire to fill the void, or if it's just perverse and empty form of affection.
I'm with my bitch.
Or if he's actually currently pursuing a partner. But regardless, it hits the nail on the head in terms of capturing that hollow and desperate desire to be loved and fill that hole in your chest in any way that you can. This Empty Love is the next track, and it's my personal favorite song that the band ever made. It's an incredibly moving song in both its brilliant production and its cutting and emotional lyrics. The song starts off with a shrill but hollow synth chord, something similar to what you would hear Akira Yamaoka use in his soundtracks for the Silent Hill series. This chord progression is joined by a groovy but simple bass line and drum machine, following an almost breath-like pattern as they go up and down, leaving empty spaces for the sounds to ring out while Patrick sings very soft and solemnly. As the song plays out, it evolves into a heavily layered and intense track with Patrick's vocals taking on a much more powerful tone, though it's the lyrics that really steal the show here, with the verses describing the uncomfortable and dreadful feeling of leaving a one-night stand after a night of partying and sweet nothings, hence the title of the song.
I leave the bed to gather up my clothes. She covers up her skin, I'm moving for the door. She says, if you walk out now, this is the last time that we speak. You will tell her that you love her, so then why can't you love me? Don't make promises that you can't keep. Her eyes are open.
The chorus, on the other hand, just repeat the same name of the song, letting the music and atmosphere really convey the emotion of the moment. It's all just perfect in my opinion, and if you listen to just one song from this album, it should be this one. The song that follows is New Poetry, a track about embracing a toxic relationship, an attempt to find meaning in a society that has nothing to offer but materialism and hedonistic pleasure. Also, it's extremely catchy.
New poetry. It's the language that we speak. I've become numb.
This Town Will Be Your Grave is a big shakeup to the album at this point, both musically and lyrically. The music itself is much more upbeat and heavy, leaning into the band's more industrial influences. The lyrics on this track are much more gritty and cutting than the last few songs, which focused on hedonism.
We will be the future, and you will never change.
This Town Will Be Your Grave is about being stuck in a society that embraces nihilism, where everyone has become a shell of the people they could have been, living in regret of the choices that they made. A place where the masses reach out desperately for meaning, only to find that all they have is nothing. And in the end, it all meant nothing.
The cross they bear, a burden they can't stand. They're holding onto nothing. Time is slipping through their hands. So easily they point the finger, the first to pass the blame. We will be the future, and you will never change.
Brutal and cold, but I can't say the song is wrong in terms of its view on how much complacency and acceptance can lead to stagnation and decay. Heart of Fire is a song that was previously released on the Download EP, but it's here that we get to hear it in its full glory. In the context of this album, it fits perfectly. The track details Patrick embracing the lies of modern relationships and trying to numb the void he feels eating at him by sharing it with those around him.
I remember you from a better time. Conversations saturated with telling lies. All this comes back to the love I spoke with honest and pure eyes. Something meaningful to get you and fall in love. It was easier to tell you everything you wanted to hear.
With the context of the album, this song hits way harder than it ever could have alone. And with its more upbeat and major scale feel in the instrumental, it clashes perfectly with the final song on the album, What We'll Never Know. Heart of Fire served as a reprieve from the downbeat and sad tone of the record in its instrumental. What We Will Never Know, however, revels in its depressive atmosphere. The song opens up with the somber and floaty synths and trip-hop drum beats that we've come to expect, really bringing in that heavy fog of dystopia with it. The entire track carries a conclusive and bookending feel to it, having a more cinematic approach to its songwriting, really letting the vocals take the stage. The lyrics detail Patrick's struggle to believe he could ever be loved again, walking in the morning light, lamenting the struggles he has faced and how weak and destroyed he feels.
The fire came and went, and they took everything away. The bruises never healed, so I try to take a breath, to say what wasn't said, but there's nothing left of me. Now there is nothing left.
This verse really captures the tone of the record, where after living a life of nihilistic decadence and chasing hedonism to fill the void that society has left inside him, Patrick now confronts the cold and depressing reality of the dystopian world he lives in, something the entire record has tried to convey, talking about living in excess, hedonism, and celebrity worship, only to be governed and lorded by primal impulses in a world of apathy, a world that startlingly mirrors our own. From here, the album's story comes to an end, with its outro track Home, a dark and haunting ambient piece, leaving us in the dark world that we created.
Friends, We have gathered here this morning to hold our heads high and join our hands in the friendship and goodness of the Inner Party system. For the wages of sin are death and eternal damnation. But there is salvation at the end of this holy tunnel. As it is written, there is none righteous among us, not one. Everything outside of Inner Party system is not reality. Everything outside of Inner Party system is absolutely absurd. Everything outside of Inner Party system is not reality. Everything outside of Inner Party system is absolutely absurd. All sinners drowning in the flaming lake of temptation. And the only way to reach salvation is through the Inner Party system.
After the self-titled album dropped, the band supported it on the Vans Warped Tour, as well as over the next 2 years embarking on many tours across both America and Europe. Though Island Records would not let them go very long with this, with Red Bull Music becoming the band's new home. Though this change would end up bringing an end to the band, but before departing, Inner Party System would release their final EP, Never Be Content. This EP would end up being the band's swan song, and honestly, it's one hell of a way to go out. Clocking in at 36 minutes and 6 songs long, the EP sees a shift in the band's sounds, letting the industrial and rock influences take a bit of a backseat this time around, and the more EDM and electronic elements take center stage. And this really works to the band's benefit, as the scathing satire and social criticism are much more direct on this record. The dystopian warning takes a much different direction this time around though, focusing much less on hedonism and toxic interpersonal relationships, and aiming straight for social decay in the system we rely on here in the modern age. The EP starts off with the instrumental song, And Together, a house-style track with little to no lyrics, mainly here to set a false sense of positivity compared to what ends up following, leading us into our first lyrically driven song, Money Makes the World Go Round. A track that's message is found right in the title, carrying the EDM-focused sound of the previous track to its logical extent.
Building up, make it work, keep turning it out, keep pushing, keep spending, got everything now.
Money Makes the World Go Round is a catchy track with lyrics mocking the so-called high life, only to lead us to the chorus that tells us just how dependent we are on money making our world turn. The entire song is a scathing attack on those who focus their entire life around money and production, calling out just how profit-focused our world has become and its false mask of luxury.
We are living with first-class criminals. Diamond plastic, larger than life. All eyes on you. So magnetic, you money maker, so productive.
The song is followed by what I consider to be the band's magnum opus, American Trash, an electro-industrial track that revels in seething disgust of the corporate-controlled hellscape that we call the First World.
I've got this planet in my hands. I'll try to save it if I can. I'm satisfied with myself, don't care for anyone else. I'm so united when I stand. I get my facts from the TV.
The song and its accompanying video are a masterclass in mean-spirited satire, mocking celebrities who peddle propaganda in the name of altruism, while in turn living in a life of excess, substance abuse, and self-worship. Or as the band calls them,
stupid American trash.
The next song comes in as a change of pace, with a slower tempo and less harsh approach, where we see Patrick grieve over the loss of his time, relationships, and life for the sake of touring. A much more personal song than what we've become accustomed to.
I'm out of touch with all my friends. Every time I see them again, all the days I've been away, would it be different if I stayed?
Although it's easy to look at this song in a more contextual sense, as the regret many celebrities and businesswomen would feel for sacrificing what's truly important in life, to live their lives of excess and working careers in a field that separates them from the general population, something even Billie Eilish has done in recent years. Though I do think this is the one time Patrick decided to truly get personal. The second to last track on the album is Not Getting Any Better. It's decent. It's honestly the lowest point on the album for me. It's not a bad song, it's just
fucking thing sucks.
It's kind of a generic EDM song that feels very label centric and very pushed. But nonetheless, it serves as a solid track before the real ending of the album, Squid. The closer of not only the EP, but the band itself. And by no means does it disappoint. Squid is a subdued and somber track, describing the boring woes of suburban life. Patrick describes the life most claim to want of a nuclear family in a nice house, only to find that what he wants is more out of life. That despite the comfort and safety in his decisions, it's all left him bored and remorse over not chasing his dreams and neglecting to search for what really makes him happy.
You think you had it figured out? Two-car garage on a beautiful house. Same routine keeps your feet to the ground. You're boring me to death.
This short but sweet verse cuts to the core of the issue. The lack of fulfillment that comes from only pursuing the version of success that consumerism promises. But it's the chorus where things truly come to fruition.
Hello, morning, sound alarms. There's no turning this around. The days are dragging out. Don't you love it? Hand in hand, the human race lost emotion on their face. Cause no one.
While I normally would read these lyrics to you, I feel that in the context of how the vocals play with the music and the tone of everything, it's something you have to hear to fully understand. And speaking of realization, that's what this song is ultimately about. Until you die, you are a prisoner to an alarm clock, corporate job, and expensive mortgage, living life like it's Groundhog Day, looping the weeks together in a meaningless and boring existence, with consumerism and hedonistic pleasure being the only things that you have to numb the feelings of regret and discontent for the life that you have been given, which fits into the name of this record. Never be content. The entire point was on the fucking tin.
Hello. We are in a party system.
Inner Party System would sadly come to an end after this, shelving their second full-length record, something rumored to be called All the Rest. But due to the lack of information regarding the record and uploaded leaks, well, there sadly isn't just anything to talk about. Which is tragic because what has leaked was pretty good. It was honestly some of the band's best work. Before I give my final statement, I just want to say the lack of love this band receives is absolutely devastating. They were pioneers and visionaries, creating not just amazing music, but beautiful and amazing videos to go along with it, further building the world and presenting the message of the band. The mishandling they got from labels was also incredibly sad, with Island opting to market them alongside popular post-hardcore and emo bands at the time, preventing IPS from finding the audience that they deserved. I hope this video piques your interest because the band is truly one of a kind, and you just gotta listen to the music. It's fantastic, and their message is important, and the sound is some of the best you'll ever hear. But with that being said, subscribe, support me on Patreon, follow me on Twitter. I'll see you in the next video.
It's me, Madison Ray. Play up your pathetic little band pennies.